الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد، إن شاء الله تعالى we're going to carry on the topic of المدخل إلى علوم القرآن, the introduction to the science of Quran. Today we're going to speak about Al-Makki wal-Madani. Today we're going to speak about Al-Makki wal-Madani, the Meccan surahs and the Madanian surahs. So we're going to speak about Al-Makki wal-Madani. So what does Al-Makki mean? Al-Makki is ما نزل قبل الهجرة. There's many statements and views. Makki is anything that came down before the hijrah. ما نزل قبل الهجرة. Anything that came down before the hijrah. The reason why we say before the hijrah, even if it came down in other than Makkah, it doesn't have to come down in Mecca. It's as long as it's before the hijrah. So for example, if the Messenger ﷺ was in Taif, and this is before the hijrah, he was in Taif. Remember when he got stoned and pushed out of Taif? Quran that came down in Taif is called Makki, because it came down before the hijrah. Are you with me, brothers? And anything that came down بعد الهجرة, so ما نزل anything that came down in what? After the hijrah. It's considered what? Madanian, even if it came down in Mecca. Are you with me, brothers? Like the ayat that came down in Hajj, اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. It came down in Arafah. But what is it called? Madani. Even though it's Mecca and it's in, it's called what? Madani. Why? Because it came down after the hijrah. Are you with me, brothers? So now we understand what it is Makki and Madani. This is the strongest opinion, that Makki is anything that came down before the hijrah, and Madani is what came down after the hijrah. Anything that came down after the hijrah. That's the first point. The first point was today what? To define what Makki means and to define what Madani means. Good. Now we're going to move on to the next one, which is how many surahs in the Quran are Makki and how many surahs in the Quran are Madani. How many surahs are Madaniyah and how many are Makkiyah? The Madani are 20. The Madani are 20. 20 of it is Madaniyah. And the second one is Makki is what? 80? 82. And 12 is disputed. So we divide it into three. Are you with me, brothers? 82 of them came down in what? Mecca. 20 of it came down in what? And 12 of it is disputed. Is it Makki or is it Madani? Khilaf. Does that make sense? Benefit. Take this benefit down. Which one is more? Who believes which one? Who put your hand up if you believe Makki is more? I believe Makki is more. Who believes Makki is more? Who believes Madani is more? I also believe Madani is more. Oh yeah, how did that happen? Huh? Ah, good. So Makki is more in numbers of surahs. And Madani are more in size. If you open the Quran now and you look at the 20 that are Makki and Madani, you see it's bigger, it's more thicker than the part that's what? The surahs that are Makki are small. Does that make sense? And this is the justice of Allah Azza wa Jal. And 12 is what? 12 is مُخْتَلَفٌ فِيهِ. It's disputed. Where should we take it? Should we say Makki? Should we say Madani? Okay, scholars, they disputed regarding it. So what do? We define what Makki and Madani means. True or false? True, false? Did I define what Makki and Madani is? We now know what it is, right? Point number two. Did I tell you how much Makki are and how much are Madani? Did I? Yeah? Good. Point number three. How do we recognize Makki and how do we know Madani? How do we recognize it? At-tariqu ila ma'rifati al-Makki and at-tariqatu ila ma'rifati al-Madani. So the next point is, how do we recognize it? How do you recognize what is Makki? At-tariqu ila ma'rifة المكي والمدني. How do we recognize it? Number one, the first way that we recognize it is, it's in two ways, first of all. It's in what? It's in two ways. The first one is النقل السماعي. The first one is النقل السماعي, by transmission. Transmission is the first way that we know Makki from Madani. Okay, نقل here is transmission, السماعي is oral transmission. Okay, oral transmission, meaning the companions will say to us that this surah came down here and this one came down. It came down. ولذلك عبد الله بن عباس, when it came to the ayah, يا أيها النبي حسبك الله ومن اتبعك من المؤمنين. This ayah, what did Ibn Abbas say? He said, نزل بعد إسلام عمر. After Abu Umar رضي الله عنه became a Muslim, Allah sent down this ayah, يا أيها النبي حسبك الله. Allah is enough for you, Muhammad. You and your followers. Allah is going to take care of you. Look at that. Umar is coming to Islam. Honor for Islam and the Muslims. Are you with me, brothers? When did Umar take Islam? Mecca or Medina? Then we know this ayah is what? We know it's Makki. We know it's what? We know it's Makki. So this is naqlun sama'i. So we have an oral transmission for it. Also the ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, بَلِ السَّاعَةُ مَوْعِدُهُمْ وَالسَّاعَةُ أَدْهَا وَأَمَرُ. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, it came down وَأَنَا عِنْدَهُ, and I was with him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It came down, she said. Surah Al-Baqarah, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, and Surah Al-Nisa, what did she say? I was with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when it came down. So we know Surah Al-Nisa and Surah Al-Baqarah and this ayah in Surah Al-Qamar, all of them came down in what? In Medina, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when did he enter onto Aisha? In Medina. Then this is naql sama'i, orally. I have a chain, sahabi saying this. I'm a sahabiya saying this. The second type in which we can know what is the second way to know Makki from Madani is al-qiyas al-ijtihadi. Are you with me, brothers? The first one that I mentioned, which is a naql sama'i, the first one, which ones fall into this? The two types that we mentioned before, The 82 that were what? That were Makki. And the 20 that were what? Madani. All of those are naql sama'i. We have transmission for that. That's why those are agreed. Lakin the 12 that are disputed is all based upon what? Al-qiyasul ijtihadi. Scholars are doing independent reasoning. What are they doing? The independent reasoning, they're looking. Ah, how can we know this is... Each one is saying, nah, it follows my guidelines. No, the other one says, no, it's not following your guidelines. It's actually following my guidelines, it's Madani. No, the other one says, no, it's Makki. I found this and this characteristics in it. Okay? In order to say that it's Makki. Okay, we're going to now stand over this one. This one we already know. We have sanad for it. We have chain, we look into it, Makki and Madani. This 12, what guideline did the scholars follow in order to determine it's Makki or a Madani? Does that make sense? This 12. Am I making sense? Yeah? Why does it feel like I'm not? Why do I feel like I'm not making sense? Am I making sense? Okay. How did they recognize it? Or how did they determine these 12? They follow two things. What did they follow? They follow two things. The first one is called As-Simat Al-Lafziyah. And the second one is As-Simat Al-Mawdu'iyah. What do they follow? As-simat al-lafziyah. They looked at the wordings that are used in Mecca and the wordings that are used in Medina, and they made that their distinguishing factor. So simat here means, simat means characteristics, attributes. So they looked at the wordings. What type of wordings, okay, were used in Mecca? And if they see that in an ayah, they say what? Because they already have 20 that are Madani, and they have 82 which is Makki. So they look at the 20 of Mecca that they have, 20 of Medina that they have, and they use that as a guideline to identify. And the 82 which is Mecca, they look at the wordings that are used here. For example, let's look at wordings that are known to be used. The word kalla. The word kalla. This word kalla is known as in the suwar al-makiyyah. The word kalla, it's known in Mecca. It's being used in Mecca. The reason is because they say it's being used as a zajr and a tawbikh, rebuking, scolding. And they said this was because of the mushriki Quraysh. This is the language that was used for Quraysh. Kalla, when you read in the Quran. Kalla la tuti'hu wasjud waqtarib. Find that. So it's Surah Makkiyah. The second thing that they mention is sujud sajda. The wordings that are mentioned to prostrate, fasjudu lillahi wa'budun, it's used in what? Mecca. So the second one is, so the word kalla, second one is sujood at-tilawa. Okay, sujood at-tilawa. It's wordings that are used in what? It's Meccan, so they identify that with Mecca. Al-qasam, promises and oaths that are used. Like لا أقسم بهذا البلد والفجر والضحى والليل, and all of them are what? They generally what? Al-Qasam. So they looked at these words and these are Meccan or Medinian, etc. Very good. When we look at words that talk about hudud meaning capital punishments, fara'id, obligatory acts. Like this is obligatory, you have to do this action. mainly sharia, legislations, zakat, sawm, hajj, things like that. They are generally madaniyin. Are you with me, brothers? Nifaq and the munafiqeen. There was no munafiqeen in Mecca. Are you with me, brothers? But in Medina, there was munafiqeen. So exposing the munafiqeen and talking about the munafiqeen is in Medina. So these are worries that they realize what? Simat lafdiyah. This is where the ijtihad is based on. Are you with me, brothers? The second way that they look at it is simat mawdu'iyah. They look at the topic that's being discussed here. Are you with me, brothers? They may not see the word that they're looking for, but they might look at the topic that it's talking about. Simat mawdu'iyah. The overall meaning of this verse. What is it talking about? So for example, the surahs in Mecca, they talk about mainly what? Aqeedah. They talk about at-tawheed, ibtal al-shirk, speaking about shirk, idol worshipping, believing in the resurrection. Sahih? That topic and that meaning is mainly what? Good. Madaniyan lakin, what is it known for? It's known for the topics of ibadah, right? The topics of ibadah that we know. Books of ibadah, what do they deal with? Generally, if you open a fiqh book and you're studying a fiqh book, the scholars, they categorize it into how many? There's different types of taqseemat, but al-ibadat. And then you have al-mu'amalat. And then you have al-nikah. And then you have al-hudud. Transaction is mu'amalat, buyu' and stuff like that. Fiqh books are only these four. Are you with me, brothers? So you, al-ibadat, this is issues pertaining to Medina. Al-mu'amalat, transaction, buying and selling, Medina. That's where Medina came. Rulings to it. Nikah and its rulings, Medina. All this came about in Medina. Al-hudud, capital punishments and whatnot. All of this came in what? In Medina. Generally speaking. لكن ما يتعلق بالتوحيد والبعث والنشور, resurrection, day of judgment, believing in Allah تبارك وتعالى and etc. This is mainly what? Mainly Mecca. Mainly Mecca. Okay? Doesn't mean that it wasn't mentioned in Medina. It was mentioned in Medina. But Medina now, other things have been added on now. Also, Medina, it has, they realized, and there's a dispute whether we should put this into simat al-lafdiyah or the simat al-mawdu'iyah. Medina, if you look at it, the ayat are longer. And in Mecca, the ayat are what? Shorter. I want to take a benefit out of this. Ibn al-Qayyim, well, he took the benefit out of it, but I want to share it with you. Do you know why Mecca has shorter verses and Medina has longer verses? Because Mecca, the people were eloquent. They were Arabs. They didn't need a lot of kalam. Summarized to the point, they understood. Like in Medina, they were not as eloquent as the people of Mecca. So the ayat needed to explain itself more. And this is something that brings me to the next point, which is, why is it beneficial to learn Makki and Madani? All of these are things that you learn. When you're talking to a group of people who are intellectual and smart, there's a way that you talk to them. And when you're talking to people who need some things to be broken down and to be made easy and to explain, you learn to do that. This is where they take from balagha, mura'at muqtada al-mukhatab, observing who you're talking to and the person you're discussing with. The Quran teaches you how to talk. It teaches you how to conduct yourself. Are you with me, brothers? It teaches you, before you speak to this person, find out what is it that they are lacking. What are they lacking? And in marketing, before you go for an interview, right, job, just mithal, what do? You look up the company that's going to give you the job, huh? You learn about it, you see what they are, their history, they're about, their, and then when they ask you questions, you say, yeah, I've looked at your company, your revenue is this much, and this is how much you turned over, and the gross profit, and وما إلى ذلك, صحيح? And when they see that you've read about them, what happens? Whoa, you know, we're going to give you the job, man. You're a really serious guy. But all of these fawaid, are found in the Quran and the Sunnah. What did the Prophet say to Mu'adh? Ya Mu'adh, innaka satati qawm ahl kitab. Mu'adh, you're going to go to the people of the scripture. He told him in advance, be careful. These are not normal people. They are not amatun nas. They have a scripture. They have a book. They have a religion. They're going to come with doubts. They're going to come out with arguments. They're going to come out with points. Innaka satati qawm ahl kitab. Are you with me, brothers? Learning who you're going to talk to. And who you're going to... and who you're going to discuss issues with. But if a person comes up to you and he asks you a question, your question will be so effective if you try to look at the surroundings and the place that you're at. Are you with me, brothers? Well, like some of the mashayikhs, when they came and visited us in the UK, the first day what they would do is they would ask us about the country and the culture and what is it that people do and how do people spend their time. And wallahi, we saw some of the mashayikhs do that. So when they gave the fatwa, they knew where it was, the answer was going. Are you with me? They knew how they were dealing with the issue. Because the fatwa, it revolves around what? To know the waqi'ah that you're dealing with and the situation that you're dealing with and the people that you're tackling their issue. Okay. So those are the benefits that learning Makki and Madani benefits you. Also, by studying the Makki and the Madani, what does it also give you? It gives you the ability to know what verse is abrogated and what isn't abrogated. For example, if we can't reconcile between a Makki and a Madani, what do? We'll say that the Makki abrogated the Madani. Sorry, the Madani abrogated the Makki. The Madani, because it came later, it abrogated this ruling. This ruling is no longer implemented. Are you with me? Knowing the timing, that's the benefit. It helps you when you come to the chapter of ما يتعلق بالتعارض والترجيح. Texts coming together, how to reconcile between them. It will benefit you, inshallah ta'ala. You'll also learn أسلوب الدعوة, how to give دعوة. Just by studying Makki and Madani, you will learn how to give دعوة. How the Messenger gave Makkah, دعوة in Makkah, and how he gave what? In Medina. Are you with me, brothers? I think, inshallah ta'ala, that is what we needed for today regarding this one, inshallah ta'ala. أسأل الله أن يبارك فيكم وأن يوفقكم لما يحبه ويرضى ويجعلكم من أهل القرآن أهله وخاصته. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and shaytan, and Allah and his messenger are free from it. سبحانك اللهم بحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. Any questions? فضل. Yes. Yes. Doesn't mean every surah that's Makki, that every ayah in it is Makki. Some scholars will say, this surah is Makkiya illa ayat kada wa kada. This surah is Makki except ayah so and so, it's Madani. Are you with me, brothers? It could happen. Now. When did it start to come out? As you can see, Abdullah ibn Abbas was saying this. As in, these were the... because it wasn't stated. Remember, they didn't give all of their importance. The brother asked a very good question. He said, where did they find out Makki from Madani? And I said, the Sahabas mentioned it. So the brother asked another question. He said, what about the third group? How did they come about then? The group that are disputing. If the Sahaba spoke about this issue, then that means we should all have the Naql al-Sama'i. We don't need the Tariqa, which is Al-Qiyas al-Ijtihadi then. The Sahaba didn't speak about every verse. There are some places nobody spoke about. We don't have no Naql al-Sama'i for. We have no oral textual evidence for it. Silent about. No one spoke about it. No one said anything about it. That's why you find that some of the scholars, they differ on the abrogation due to the fact of Makki and Madani. ولذلك there's a line of poetry that I advise you all to memorize if you want to know all of the surahs which are Makki and all of the surahs which are Madani. I will speak to brother Munawwar and inshallah ta'ala he will send you the lines of poetry to memorize inshallah ta'ala. It will benefit you. Just memorize it. It's about 20 lines or so. You learn the surahs which are Madani and the surahs which are Makki. Inshallah ta'ala. Today I apologize, I really went fast in Aqeedah, but I had to, it was my last class. I had no other option. I had to go fast in Aqeedah. But I know inshallah it's recorded. So bi'idhnillah you can go to the recording and go over it again and again. And if you do have any questions on any issue regarding the Aqeedah that I said that you didn't understand, inshallah ta'ala you can call in to have a session with me. And the kalima, call Munawwar, you can have a session, ask me the questions that you have, if you want me to explain some issues for you. Why did I say that? Some brothers, they were like, You have that option, inshallah ta'ala. Okay, there's three questions from the sisters. Can you please repeat the three things that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked Allah, out of which two were granted? The three that he asked them was, قُلْ هُوَ الْقَادِرُ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَبْعَثَ عَلَيْكُمْ عَذَابًا مِنْ فَوْقِكُمْ. That Allah does not punish the people with one punishment. What they call a natural disaster. We don't believe it's natural disaster. We believe it's Allah's punishment. Or Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is testing. Okay? It's not natural. It doesn't just happen. It happens with whose will? بِمَشِيَأَةِ. So like floods, earthquakes. It happens, but the Prophet made dua that it doesn't happen to the ummah all at once. So you're not going to see the whole world earthquake today. It won't happen. But it might happen in one place and not another place. So Allah said, I'll give that to you. The second dua that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made was, oh Allah, don't bring an enemy to my ummah, يَسْتَبِيحُ بَيْضَتَهُمْ, that takes everything that they own and takes their land and everything and massacres them and butchers them. To the ummah in totality, oh Allah, don't that. So it may happen in one place and not another place. Allah said, I'll give that to you. The third one was to divide my ummah into groups and they make each other taste pain. Allah said, this one I won't give you. This one I won't give you. So this one happens, it takes place. It's happening everywhere in the world right now, sah? May Allah unite us upon the haqq. Oh Allah, unite us upon the haqq. The second question is, the two subdivisions under the ghulat of the Shia. The two groups we mentioned under the Shia, the ghulat were the Nusayriya and Ismailiyya, right? We said the Nusayriya and Ismailiyya. What does al-wa'd wal-wa'id mean? Al-wa'd wal-wa'id means, Allah made promises in the Quran, right? Did Allah make promises? And what did Allah also promise? Punishments, right? Is Allah going to fulfill all of the promises that He makes and all the punishments? Ahlul Sunnah believe Allah Azza wa Jalla, He will fulfill the promises that He made. But as for the punishments, because He's very merciful, He may choose to not put a person through a punishment. Like in the Mu'tazila, they believe in fadul wa'd wal wa'id. In fadul wa'id. Did Allah not promise that He's going to punish you for drinking khamar? He's going to punish you. There's no way out of this one. Does that make sense? Are you there? Ahlul Sunnah said, no. Punishments are tahta mashi'ati Allah. In sha'a afa anhu wa in sha'a ghafara. In sha'a adhaba. If Allah wants, He punishes the person, and if He wants, He let the person go. They said, no. So what they confused with one another is what? The one that Allah is going to do is the promises He makes. As for the punishments, this is where the mercy comes into place. If He wants, He lets the person go and He forgives them. And if He wants, He what? He punishes the person depending on how He wants it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's what wa'ad wal-wa'id means. And the issue of wa'ad wal-wa'id, it really falls under the issue of murtaqib al-kabira. All of these we will speak about in books of Aqeedah, inshallah ta'ala. Yeah, I answered it. اسمع الموضوعية ها مكي ها مكي أسد توحيد العقيدة توحيد العقيدة توحيد mainly توحيد and البعث resurrection those knee are mainly what Mecca deals with also and just a side benefit inshallah ta'ala I would advise you all Sheikh Sulaiman al-Ruhayli is here right now he's here he's got a dawra he started yesterday he went through a nice benefit with us I would advise you to all come to benefit inshallah ta'ala today is after what al-Maghrib right after Asr try to come inshallah ta'ala to benefit from that dawra inshallah it's about marriage and wives and spouse and etc. It's a benefit. A lot of us have these questions all the time. Assimat means characteristics, attributes. Fadl here.
What's the second book that Abul Hassan al-Ash'ari wrote?
It's cool. He wrote a lot of books.
No, the second one for to show that he repented. Risalatu
ila ahli al-thaghar. Any other questions? Fadl. Oh, sorry, you had a question first.
Well, it's not like you mentioned in the last class, this class is related to the last class we received. What about the interpretations of the Quran that the people make about science, like the embryology and cosmology and the Big Bang, the interpretations? Is it the same, like no Salaf has preceded us in this, so we reject that?
This issue of taking the Quran as a science book. Why? Because science is based upon dhanniyat, speculation and assumption. And so science is evolving, it's changing. And one day it's this and one day it's that. And so if you say that this ayah means this, and the iktishaf, after investigation they find out, oh, you know what, the world is flat. It's actually not round. Okay? And then they say to you, the world is, are you saying, no, there's an ayah for us that supports us. And they say, you know what, it's round again. And then you go, you've got another ayah for that one as well. Sahih? Because science is based upon induction, it's based upon tatabbu' and istiqra. It's not solid and it's changing and it's time. Because humans' observation is very weak. We haven't seen everything. And the Quran has to be still. Are you with me, brothers? So interpreting the Quran into science points, it has its problems. But recently, in London, what happened? We found a mushaf that was found in Birmingham. You remember, brothers? In the UK, it was a mushaf was found, and I told some brothers, let's not give it any publicity, because we believe it regardless of whether it's found or not. Why? The reason why I say if we give and we use this as evidence and say, Alhamdulillah, a mushaf has been found and it really resembles the mushaf that we have now. Allahu Akbar, nahnu ala al-haq, we are upon the haq. And we use that as an argument. What about if they say, we found another portion of it, it doesn't go according to your Quran. What are you going to do now? Are you with me, brothers? For us, we don't even base our evidence aslan upon this mushaf that was found. Whether it's found or not, we have asanid, riwayat. Turuq, chains we looked at. This is what it reached, something called haddu tawatur, multitude narration. Are you with me, brothers? So a Muslim should be very dhiki, fatin, aqil. Your way of saying that this is my evidence is different to, they look at carbon. This is what the carbon dating is what they're using. Carbon dating for you is not a tatariqa min turuq ithbatil. It's not a way to affirm a book. So aslan, you're in a trouble. When later they say, oh, we found another portion of the Quran or another part of it, you can't get out of it. Because you used that as the evidence yesterday. So it's going to be a halalun ala balabilihi dawhu halalun littayri min kulli jinsi. When you want it, you can use it. When you don't, you're like, no, this is wrong. It's not, they're wrong. You can't say that later. Okay? Last question. That's a long discussion. Hada muhadarat. It's a long discussion. لكن المسألة فيه تفصيل. I read a kitab written by the kalam of Imam Ibn al-Qayyim, his kitab Tariq al-Salah. There's a kitab called Hukm Tariq al-Salah, Ibn al-Qayyim. He talks about it in that book. Rahimahullah ta'ala. Okay, stop there inshallah ta'ala. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.